JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for September the 3rd. I am Charalambos Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded lower against all but one of the other major currencies on Thursday and during the Asian session Friday. It lost the most ground versus NZD, CAD and AUD in that order, while it lost the least ground versus CHF. The currency against which the greenback did not underperform was the Japanese yen. Now, the weakening of the US dollar and the Japanese yen, combined with the strengthening of the risk-linked Kiwi, Luni and Aussie, suggests that financial markets continued trading in a risk-on fashion yesterday and today in Asia. Indeed, looking at the performance in the equity world, we see that all but one of the major EU and US indices closed slightly positive, driven by energy stocks, as oil prices gained decently on the back of a sharp decline in US inventories and a weaker US dollar. In Asia, Japan's Nikkei 225 and South Korea's KOSPI also traded positive, but China's Shanghai Composite and South Korea's China's Shanghai Composite and Hong Kong's Hang Seng slid. Now, Japan's Nikkei rallied nearly 2%, perhaps as Japan's Prime Minister Suga said he would step down, setting the stage for a new leader. The outcome was seen as favorable by the markets due to the criticism Suga received in handling the coronavirus pandemic. Actually, his support ratings sank to below 30%, and with that in mind, investors may have cheered the prospect of better days with a new prime minister. Suga will finish his term as the ruling Liberal Democratic Party president until his successor is chosen on September 29th through party elections. The new LTD president will also be the new premier because of the LDP's majority in the lower house. Thus, we don't believe that there will be drastic changes with regards to the new government's policies. The new general elections are expected to be held on October 17th. Now, the spotlight is likely to fall on the U.S. employment report for August, due to be released later today. Non-farm payrolls are expected to have slowed to 750k from 943k, but the unemployment rate is anticipated to have slid to 5.2% from 5.4%. Average hourly earnings are forecast to have grown another 0.4% month over month, the same pace as in July, something that is likely to keep the year-over-year rate unchanged at 4%. Now, despite the hawkish views by several of his colleagues, Fed Chair Powell maintained a cautious stance in his Jackson Hole speech. He acknowledged the progress of the US economy towards the Fed's objectives, but refrained from providing clear signals with regards to when they may begin tapering their quantitative easing purchases. He added that he wants to avoid chasing transitory inflation and potentially discouraging jobs growth in the process. On Wednesday, the ADP report missed its own estimate by a large margin, with some participants raising their bets over a later quantitative easing tapering by the Fed. However, we repeat once again that we are reluctant to rely much on the ADP number, as it is proved to be far from a reliable predictor for the NFPs. Even last month, when the ADP number fell to 330k from 680k, the NFPs held more or less steady at around 940k. as we noted in the past, the median, as we already noted, the forecast, the median forecast for the NFPs is 750k, but the range of the estimates is from 375k to 1.02 millions, which suggests that analysts and market participants do not have yet a clear picture over how the labor market fared during the month. In any case, the median forecasts still point to another decent report, something that could revive speculation over a quantitative easing tapering as early as at the upcoming Fed gathering and may help the dollar to rebound. The opposite could be true if we see the actual number coming closer to the lower bound of the estimates range. This could keep the greenback under pressure and allow equities to continue sailing north, as later tapering could also mean later rate hikes and thereby lower borrowing costs for companies for longer. Now, as for the rest of today's events, besides the US jobs data, we do get the final services and composite PMIs from the Eurozone, the UK and the US, but as it is always the case, they are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates. The ASM non-manufacturing PMI for August is also coming out, and it is expected to have slid to 61.8 from 64.1. So, that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm hosting every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So, goodbye, have a great day, a greater weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next week.
JFT, just fair and direct.